the audio portion of the meeting. Thank you for dialing in to today's Link and Learn, which will aim to give an outlook on investment management tax for 2019. On the next slide, you'll see the Deloitte team presenting for you today and the agenda for discussion. So we can just, Ninad, if you can just flick the slides along one. Okay, so I'm Joanne Mawinney. I'm a director in the London Asset Management Tax team. With me is my colleague Ian Akong, an associate director in the team. Our Luxembourg firm is represented by Ninad Illick today, and Seamus Kennedy and Sybil Smith are dialing in from Dublin. We'll be touching on the themes of Brexit, ATAD, DAC 6, the BEPS multilateral instrument, UK non-resident capital gains tax changes, and recent developments in the area of substance requirements for the Channel Islands and Cayman Islands. We invite you to submit your questions throughout the presentation, and the final item will be a Q&A session. Given the busy agenda and the timing, we will proceed directly to the first item, which is Brexit. So to the next slide, please. Ahead of, and certainly since the UK's decision to leave the European Union, the asset management industry has been alive to the magnitude of business change this would result in. The two main areas of concern are the loss of regulatory passporting and, for firms with UK fund ranges, the loss of UCITS designation for our domestic products. Given our audience today, my comments will touch on both, but focus on the former, which is likely to be more relevant to the wider audience. The loss of regulatory passporting ability will impact both the ability of UK licensed management companies to manage EU funds and arguably some segregated mandates. It will also impact the ability to distribute funds using a MiFID license, which is currently held in the UK. On the UK product side, there will be a general loss of UCITS status once the UK ceases to be within the EU, with the potential consequence that UK funds may lose access to certain beneficial regimes, which tend to apply to UCITS funds resident in the EU today. If we move on to the next slide, assuming the loss of regulatory passporting and looking first at the diagram on the left, UK license management codes will no longer be able to manage EU funds. As a result, we expect that the management contracts will have to move across to an appropriately regulated and domiciled EU man code. Despite some initial sentiment in the industry that there should be no exit charge for that movement of contracts as a result of Brexit restructuring, through detailed conversations with industry and HMRC, it's become clear that while HMRC are not seeking to use Brexit restructuring as a revenue generator, they do expect that any transfer of value is appropriately taxed as an exit charge. Working with HMRC and the industry, and indeed making an approach for an approval on a methodology for some of our clients, we're actually looking at the operations which are factually transferred in order to attribute a precise value to the functions transferred, where we assume that the functional portfolio management will, by and large, actually be sub-delegated back to the UK ManCo, where the folks are already on the ground now. That's instead of the alternative, where the value deemed to be transferred would be the gross value of that management contract. There could be less of an impact where houses have segregated mandates, which are currently managed from the UK, as we're aware that in certain EU jurisdictions, commitments have been made to ensure that local law will be amended ahead of Brexit to permit continued management by a UK ManCo of an EU investor's segregated mandate. Generally, it's hoped that portfolio management could be sub-delegated back to the existing UK firm. However, this may need to be considered in light of local regulatory substance requirements, which we are seeing from both the CSSF and the Central Bank in Ireland. For distribution functions, and on the right, these will need to be moved to an EU licensed firm. A and given the general structure of a distribution function within an asset management house, we expect that there would be two potential transfers to consider, which could each have a tax impact. The first is akin to the transfer of the investment management contract, which is the contract for distribution activities, which you can see at the top end of the right-hand diagram. And secondly, what we do see is the recognition of permanent establishments or creation of branches where that UK licensed distributor is actually conducting activities throughout the EU. So where the distribution activity is moving across to a new or existing EU distributor, we also have to think about what the direct and indirect tax consequences of that transfer of branch activity could be for asset managers. Again, valuation of the activities or rights to distribute is a point of discussion with HMRC and within the industry. On balance, we expect that there would be a value attributable, but we're working with HMRC to really, again, reduce the taxable base of that transfer and not view it as a transfer of the contract, depending on the legals, and try and get to a referral fee arrangement. In terms of the branches, common consideration here has also been around whether a UK branch of the new EU distributor could house a lot of the existing sales and distribution staff. I think, as with the management activity delegation, this will have to be considered in light of local regulatory requirements. It definitely doesn't seem like there's a race to the bottom at the minute, and in terms of staffing requirements, they have been relatively high and could prove quite onerous and challenging to some leaner organisations who are facing a movement of their UK MiFID licence. So if we move on to the next slide. For those with UK fund ranges that they were successfully distributing to continental European clients, there's a clear consideration as to how they'll need to react to Brexit in a manner which will protect their ongoing ability to sell the product into the EU investor market. Typically, what we're seeing is the creation of a parallel range. Indeed, even for some managers who currently have EU product, we have queries around the setting up of onshore UK ranges, just depending on the current and future target investor base. Generally, we would expect that any such restructure will have been undertaken in a way where the investor and investment level tax position is reserved as best as it can be, mitigating where possible the cost of any such move. It's likely that most of these restructures have already occurred, although the establishment of a UK fund vehicle appears to be a more recent query from our continental client base. At the investment level, it's going to be important to for existing UK ranges to consider which at-source reliefs they're currently accessing, which could be lost for the remaining UK investors as the UK fund now becomes an ACE. Generally, these restructures have been done either as a drop-down or a share-for-share exchange, but that will also be coloured by the local treatment of the EU investors' tax authority when they're viewing the disposal as either a tax event or something which can access rollover relief. If we just move on to the next slide. And I'll hand over to you, Seamus.
From an Irish perspective, the Irish government has been very recently, quite active in terms of, publishing and indeed being seen to publish provisions, or at least draft provisions, which should Brexit proceed on the 29th of March and should the UK no longer be a EU member after that date, which would kick in and would become effective. The tax provisions here are part of a wider bill, whose name you can see on the slides. It's not a very catchy title, so I won't attempt to repeat it, but it does basically allow for a widening of certain tax exemptions, certain tax reliefs, to cater for the fact that that the EU is no longer a member, or the UK is no longer a member of the EU or the EEA. I mentioned in a couple of slides time that doesn't apply across the board, and that there are certain situations where there could be a tax impact on an Irish entity or indeed on an Irish domiciled fund. Moving on to the next slide, it's a particular point, and it really is specific in its application to Irish domiciled corporate funds, which are currently claiming a reduced rate of dividend withholding tax on certain sources of UK or US income. Accessing the Ireland-US double tax treaty is difficult in itself, in that it can be quite challenging to satisfy the requirements set out in Article 23 of the treaty, which is the limitation on benefits clause. There are a number of ways that, that a fund can do that. Exchange-traded funds find it slightly easier than other funds, who themselves have to rely on effectively looking at the proportion of the investor base which is resident in the EU member states. And really, I guess the point that we're trying to get across here is where the access to the Irish-US double tax treaty is relying on there being a very high proportion of UK resident investors. Should Brexit proceed on the 29th of March, that treaty access could potentially be under threat. And with the resulting impact being that the withholding tax rate on certain sources of US income would jump from 15% back up to 20%, which in certain cases could be a significant impact for the NAV of the fund. Moving on to the impact on Irish real estate funds, and this is something that the full scope of the regime and the details of it have been discussed in previous webinars. So we don't propose to take you through that again today, but it's really just to flag that the Irish tax regime around Irish real estate funds has been with us now for about 2 years, slightly over 2 years. The effect of it was really to introduce a 20% withholding tax on payments from Irish real estate funds, so effectively Irish funds which invest into Irish property assets. The withholding tax was didn't apply based on certain types of exemptions applying to either the portfolio or to the investors. On the investor side specifically, those exemptions are available to pension funds, investment funds, life assurance companies, but only to the extent that they are a tax resident in the EU or an EEA jurisdiction, and that they are subject to equivalent supervision and regulation as their Irish equivalent would be. Obviously, again, post 29 March, should the UK no longer be part of the EU, that exemption will no longer apply to payments by Irish real estate funds to UK tax residents investors, regardless of their ability to prove the equivalence condition. So it may be a case that, that people are not aware of that, and that should any payments be made after that date, that withholding will need to be applied. There are provisions in law and within the Ireland-UK double tax treaty that would facilitate a reclaim of any withholding tax suffered. The only word of warning I would mention there is that the Irish Revenue are still working on putting in place an efficient system to facilitate treaty-based reclaims. So although the technical possibility exists for reclaims to happen, it could take some time for the reclaim to actually be paid out. Passing over to Nina now to take you through some of the Lux tax considerations.
Thank you, Seamus. So unlike in Ireland, there is no changes foreseen in Luxembourg corporate income tax law or other tax laws due to Brexit. What we have is a couple of draft laws that are aimed to ensure passporting capabilities of UK asset managers post-Brexit. We also have some provisions or draft provisions to ensure that cover basically UK residents in Luxembourg post-Brexit as well. But again, nothing that is tax-related. What we have, though, is some guidance from the Luxembourg VAT authorities, and basically where they say that There will be no transition period when it comes to VAT rules in Luxembourg, so meaning that as from March 29 midnight, UK will be considered as a third country for VAT purposes. Therefore, the supply of goods and services will be subject to rules, VAT rules, that are relevant for third countries. Other than that, we have nothing really when it comes to tax. That doesn't mean that there is no tax implication in case of Brexit-related restructurings. And basically, what I will do on the next two slides to share some observations and some practical implications due to some types of reorganizations that are due to Brexit. So what we observe is basically two types of activities over the last couple of months, and that will probably continue over the next couple of months. We have seen a number of corporate organizations where we have observed new Menco set up in Luxembourg. We have also observed very frequently functions shifted and contracts shifted from a UK Menco to Luxembourg Menco. So John briefly alluded to those earlier on. When it comes to these kind of corporate restructurings, especially when it comes to transfer of assets, and again, assets meaning tangible and intangible assets such as contracts, we need to take into consideration the exit taxation of those assets before they exit the UK and enter into Luxembourg. And as John correctly alluded to, basically what we try to achieve here is to decrease any potential exit taxation upon exit of those assets out of the UK. What we also observe is the increase in substance of the Luxembourg Menco is due to these additional functions that are transferred in contracts and assets under management. So that also has transfer pricing implications. Whereas today, Luxembourg Menco can operate with, say, a couple of people on the ground, five to six. With Brexit, we have seen a significant number, a significant increase in headcount, but also the risks undertaken in the assets employed by the Luxembourg management companies. That means that basically the remuneration of the management companies has to be increased to bring it in line with the new substance of those management companies post-Brexit. And we have been working on also assisting asset managers on determining the right pricing for these new activities that are now being performed in Luxembourg. When it comes to transfer pricing, it is also important to mention that this is not something that is specific to Luxembourg. It's not something that's unilateral. Whenever there is an increase of income of taxable profits in Luxembourg, it means there is a decrease of taxable profits somewhere else in the group. So the transfer pricing implications do not only need to be assessed in Luxembourg, but also across the group. It's very important to remember for any Brexit-related reorganizations. What we also see is a second type of reorganizations and restructurings. This is more related to the sort of to the fund side. We have seen a number of asset managers shifting assets from their UK fund range to the Luxembourg fund range. And that triggers questions related to the capital gains taxation. So any potential unrealized capital gains at the UK fund level are deemed to be realized upon transfer, because transfer is, from a tax perspective, deemed to be a sale followed by an acquisition, meaning that depending on which securities the fund invests in, there could be some capital gains tax implications upon transfer. We also see that, depending on where the securities that are invested by the fund are issued, we also see financial transfer tax and the stamp duties implications. And for instance, if for an equity fund that has invested in French, Italian, UK shares, equities, this can sometimes have a very significant impact when those assets are transferred to a Luxembourg fund. So here we advise prior to transferring assets, determine and to quantify the tax impact before the type transfer type takes place. In some certain cases, it's possible to mitigate the impact of those transfers. So it's definitely something that's worthwhile looking before the actual transfer takes place. With that, we can now move to the next topic, which is ATAD.
I briefly introduce this topic. The ATAD, which is the EU Anti-Tax Avoidance Directive, has been Something that has been it's been running for quite a long time now. It has arisen out of a pretty root and branch review at OECD level initially, and then also at EU level, to investigate and to try to come up with a common set of rules which will combat perceived abuses of international tax law. The various working parties which have addressed the different action points of the base erosion and profit shifting consultation process have at this stage come up with various action points. They have incorporated those at EU level into the Anti-Tax Avoidance Directive. The first of these directives was published in June of 2016. There was an additional one published after that, which dealt with anti-hybrids. And very briefly, I guess, it aims to address harmful tax practices in a number of ways. The use of hybrid mismatches, which to summarize it very briefly, is to take advantage or to arbitrage between the different tax treatment of particular payments, particular instruments, or particular entities in one country versus another. Interest limitation rules, so the use of debt and the use of interest, excessive interest payments, to effectively artificially shift profits from one jurisdiction to another to take advantage of lower corporation tax rates in a particular country. Exit tax rules, which is effectively the migration of companies or the transfer of assets to low tax jurisdictions, to the extent that those migrations would fall completely outside of any tax net anywhere in the world. Controlled foreign companies, again, this is an anti-abuse provision to make sure that that there isn't an artificial creation of companies and an artificial allocation of profits to low tax jurisdictions, and then general anti-abuse rules to make sure that any specific transactions, entities, or arrangements that are not affected by the particular targeted measures would not escape, just being caught by tax rules. Different countries are at different stages of implementing the directive, and the various pieces of the directive have different expiry dates in terms of when local legislation needs to be enacted to take account of them. There is an element of optionality, but really the main thrust of the rules does have to be the same, and the effect of them does have to be the same across the EU. Moving on to the next slide, we just give a very brief update on where Ireland sits in terms of its progress on these rules. And very recently, the Irish Department of Finance carried out a public consultation on the introduction of anti-hybrid and interest limitation rules. So the Irish government took the decision to do the consultation on both of those topics at the same time, given that there are clear linkages between them. That consultation has now closed, and we are basically awaiting the publication of draft legislation to see exactly what the impacts will be of how the Irish Department of Finance and how the Irish Revenue Commissioners decides to implement these rules. The introduction of anti-hybrid rules is required by the 1st of January 2020, although there is a slight additional amount of time available for the implementation of the anti-reverse hybrid rules. Effectively, for the funds industry, there was a submission made by Deloitte and also a number of industry bodies of which Deloitte is a member. And the key thrust, I guess, of these submissions is that the anti-hybrid rules should not apply to the vast majority of Irish funds. The reason being, Irish funds, just as a principle of tax law, are not subject to Irish corporation tax, and that therefore the anti-hybrid rules should not have an effect on them in terms of denying deductions, because there is no tax payable by Irish funds in any event. There are other potential ways beyond that where depending on interpretation, there could be an impact indirectly on Irish funds because of the way that payments by Irish funds are treated by foreign jurisdictions, or indeed payments from the investment portfolio of an Irish fund abroad could be perceived maybe abroad to be a hybrid payment to an Irish fund. Again, the thrust of the consultation was that you know, just because a particular tax or because of the tax authority of a particular jurisdiction chooses to tax investors in a particular way, should not necessarily have a knock-on impact on the application of the anti-hybrid rules to Irish funds. Moving on to the interest limitation rules, again, this is one that we don't really see having any significant impact for Irish funds. At least that is the intention, and that has been the thrust of the consultation submissions made to date. Again, because Irish funds are not taxable in their own right, the only complication arises where they are making interest payments to other entities which do not necessarily tax those interest payments. Those examples in practice would be relatively few and far between, but it was important just from an industry standpoint to make sure that those aspects were covered off in the submission that was made. I'll let Sybil take you through the application of the new controlled foreign company rules.
Thanks, Seamus, and good afternoon, everyone. I'm just going to give a brief overview of the controlled foreign company, or CFC rules, which were introduced in Ireland in Finance Act 2018. The CFC rules apply from the 1st of January 2019, and while they won't affect Irish funds, they could, in theory, affect corporate entities such as, for example, Irish management companies. The legislation provides that a controlled foreign company means a company that is not resident in Ireland and is controlled by a company or companies resident in Ireland. Broadly, a company will be considered to control another company where they hold or are entitled to acquire, directly or indirectly, control over the company's affairs, and in particular where they possess or are entitled to acquire the greater part of the share capital, issued share capital, or voting rights, such part of the issued share capital of the company as would entitle such person to receive the greater part of any profits available for distribution, such rights as would, in a winding up, entitle such person to receive the greater part of the assets available for distribution, or any part of the issued share capital of the company, and thereby control the composition of the board of directors. Where it has been established that a company would be considered a controlling company in respect of a CFC charge can arise where the CFC has undistributed income and the relevant Irish activities in relation to the CFC are performed by a chargeable company, which would be the Irish controlling company or a company connected with the Irish controlling company. However, the legislation provides that a CFC charge will not arise in relation to undistributed income, which is attributable to relevant Irish activities performed by a chargeable company under arrangements where it is reasonable to consider that such arrangements would be entered into persons dealing at arm's length, or the essential persons of the arrangement. Purpose of the arrangement is not to secure a tax advantage. In addition, a CFC charge will not arise in respect of undistributed income, which is attributable to the relevant Irish activities performed by a chargeable company under arrangements which are subject to Irish transfer pricing provisions. And further, a CFC charge will not arise in relation to undistributed income, which has previously been assessed to an Irish CFC charge. In light of this, we would recommend that the CFC provisions are considered, particularly where you have an Irish company who holds a controlling interest in a non-Irish company. This could give rise to an Irish CFC charge. However, there are a number of carve-outs from the Irish CFC rules which should also be borne in mind. And with that, I will pass you over to Nenad, who is going to talk through the implementation of ATAD in Luxembourg.
Thank you. So basically what I'm going to do on this slide is just give you a couple of practical implications of ATAD in Luxembourg. A first comment here, as you may see on the small chart, this depicts an alternative investment fund structure. So that means that basically the ATAD impacts for mainstream fund and asset managers is pretty much limited or even non-existent. What we see though is a couple of significant and material implications for alternative funds, private equity, real estate. And I will now explain to which extent those structures can be impacted. So basically, when it comes to hybrid mismatches, we have always had in Luxembourg structures with partnerships or corporations that were treated as corporations or partnerships in other jurisdictions. There was the tax qualification of the entity was different from in Luxembourg and in other jurisdictions. So the entity itself was considered a hybrid entity. Now, with the ATAD rule, this will no longer be possible. And the structures that have such entities and vehicles involved would need to be reviewed in detail. Also, structures that involve hybrid instruments, instruments that qualify as debt in one country and as equity in another country, would also need to be reviewed. But this is a very common kind of instrument used in these structures, and we advise strongly to review the impacts on those structures. On a scale of, say, 1 to 10, the impact of hybrid mismatch rule is clearly about 8.5 for alternative fund structures. When it comes to CFC rules, generally speaking, we see limited implications, except in cases where the subsidiaries are located, where some SPVs are located in the low tax jurisdictions, potentially Cayman Islands. This is something that we see quite often. In terms of exit taxation, the impacts are very limited. We didn't see any so far in practice. Interest limitation rules, typically the impacts here depend. First of all, for UCITS funds, these are clearly an AIS, so regulated funds. These are carved out from ATAD. They benefit from a specific exemption. Now, the SPVs that may be used in these structures could be caught by the rules, but that depends on what type of financing they get and what type and what they what is the purpose of that financing, basically. So in case of very common back-to-back financing structures where a Luxembourg SPV issues debt and uses that debt to finance other debt, these are not caused by the ATAD rules. If the debt financing is used to invest in equities or to generate other type of income, not interest but other type of income, then we could have some implications when it comes to interest limitation rules. Last but not least, we have the GAR. Here also we advise to review the existing structures to ensure that these structures do not only respect the letter of the law, but also the spirit of the law, and that they are not considered as abusive from a tax perspective. That's all from my side. I hand it over to Joanne.
Thanks, Nanad. So on ATAD, while the UK was the first adopter of the OECD recommendations on the BEPS project, there's not really much change coming in 2019 because we'd fully implemented the interest restriction and anti-hybrid measures in April and January 2017, respectively. So looking now to DAC 6, so the Sixth Amendment to the EU Directive on Administrative Cooperation, it's aiming to provide member states with additional information in order to expedite the closure of loopholes in tax legislation and react against harmful tax practices. The information that's going to be created will come about by imposing new disclosure obligations on EU intermediaries and taxpayers in relation to reportable cross-border arrangements. So we can just maybe flick on to the next slide. Reports are not going to be required to be made until July 2020, but the reporting requirements actually do already apply to those cross-border arrangements which have been entered into from the 25th of June 2018. The UK have committed that they expect to fully implement the directive regardless of the date of Brexit. So moving on to the next slide. DAC 6 will require EU intermediaries to file information on reportable arrangements to their home tax authorities. Where there isn't an EU intermediary or the EU intermediary asserts legal privilege, then the obligation to report the arrangement will fall back on the EU taxpayer. Failure to comply with the regime will result in penalties. The definition of an intermediary is broad and it captures lawyers and advisors, but it's also expected that it might apply to banks, trustees, insurance companies, asset managers, and other service providers. Intermediaries will be required to report on cross-border arrangements which involve at least one EU member state and where certain hallmarks are met. At a high level, the hallmarks are being linked to the main benefit test, related to cross-border transactions, concerning automatic exchange of information, concerning beneficial ownership, or concerning transfer pricing. The application of the hallmarks should be clarified in domestic legislation and guidance, and not all of the hallmarks are subject to a tax main benefits test, which could significantly expand the number of reportable transactions or arrangements when we compare to other existing tax disclosure regimes. For reportable cross-border arrangements implemented between 25th of June last year and 1 July 2020, the first reporting will be required after 31 August 2020. Thereafter, where the relevant hallmarks are present, certain information will have to be disclosed to the relevant tax authority within 30 days. Broadly, that information includes, amongst other things, the identification of the intermediary and relevant taxpayer, the details of the relevant hallmarks of the arrangement, a summary of the arrangement, and details of the provisions forming the basis for the arrangement. The value of any arrangement will also have to be included. So if we move to the next slide. In the UK, HMRC have been consulting widely, and in recognition of the potential scope of reportable cross-border arrangements, they have agreed that there's a need for targeted legislation that expressed a desire to see a consistent approach across the EU, and they're currently sitting within a group of tax authorities and have requested example transactions or arrangements for consideration so that they can aim to work together to get some consistency. In terms of the UK funds industry specifically, we've been requested to identify transactions or arrangements which should or could be seen as benign, because HMRC are very keen to not cause an unduly large level of reporting. They'd like to use the UK's guidance to ensure that non-critical transactions and arrangements are excluded from the scope of any reporting, but they have clarified that they do not anticipate that there will be any white list of transactions to come out in the UK guidance. Any so-called exclusions we expect to be on the basis of examples, and hence the request to industry to input their thoughts on the matter as soon as possible. Part of a working party who are interacting with HMRC on this, I understand that they're making a request that statutory regimes such as ICES in the UK are expressly excluded from the scope of reportable arrangements. HMRC have also clarified that any reported transactions or arrangements will be automatically exchanged with other participating tax authorities, and there won't be any filter performed by HMRC ahead of that exchange. So moving on to the next slide.
All right, a quick word on the multilateral instrument, the MLI. So as its name suggests, it is a legal instrument that enables countries to modify their double tax treaties on a large scale in one go. How does it work? It's basically a very smart mechanism imagined by the OECD. Basically, each country, and there is currently 87 participating countries, each country publishes a sort of a wish list of provisions of their double tax treaties that they want to modify. Then the OECD, they have a matching database. They will match the wishes from each country, and when there is a match, the treaty is will update automatically. So this is much quicker process and much less tedious process than the current process of bilateral negotiations of treaties. So we expect more than 1,400 treaties to be amended in the coming months or years under this mechanism. As I said earlier, we have currently actually 87 jurisdictions that have signed up for the MLI, another 7 that have expressed intention to sign up. How it will work? Ultimately, the MLI will need to be ratified or voted into domestic law and ratified, and the ratification instrument will need to be deposited with the OECD. It is only from this moment that the MLI will start applying at each participating country level. So when it comes to Luxembourg, actually, the law ratifying the MLI has been voted literally 3 hours ago, so very recently. And that law has not been published in the official gazette yet. Once it will be published, it will be deposited with the OECD in the coming weeks. Most of the provisions so will have practical implications from 1st of January 2020, with some of them that will apply only from 2021. I think we also have a couple of words from Ireland on this topic.
Thanks, Nina. Yeah, so Ireland's deposit its instrument of ratification with the MLI together with a list of reservations notifications on the 29th of January 2019. It's expected that the MLI will enter into force in Ireland on the 1st of May 2019 and will generally take effect in Ireland from the 1st of January 2020, subject to the other contracting jurisdictions to Ireland's double tax agreements having also deposited their instruments of ratification with the OECD. So in the context of the investment management sector, one of the key areas worth considering in further detail in the context of the MLI is around treaty abuse. Treaty abuse is a minimum standard under the MLI whereby all jurisdictions will be required to adopt a principal purpose test. The principal purpose test seeks to challenge treaty benefits where it is reasonable to conclude, having regard to all facts and circumstances, that obtaining the benefit was one of the principal purposes of any arrangement or transaction that resulted directly or indirectly in that benefit, unless it is established that granting the benefit in these circumstances would be within the spirit of the relevant provision within the double tax agreement. OECD guidance on the principal purpose test states that that obtaining the benefit under the treaty needs only to be considered one of the principal purposes of the transaction in order for the principal purpose test to apply. In other words, it does not need to be the sole or dominant purpose of the transaction. In light of this, we would recommend that the provisions of the MLI are considered in advance of the MLI taking effect in Ireland. However, it should be noted that in most cases, the MLI should not affect payments out of Ireland by an Irish fund or management company, as there are a number of domestic exemptions which may apply. As such, the MLI and the principal purpose test are more likely to affect the returns received by an Irish entity from a non-Irish investment, as it may make it more difficult to avail of treaty benefits on any inward payments received. It is also worth noting that the application of the principal purpose test in practice is likely to vary from country to country. As such, we recommend that it is considered in respect of all investment jurisdictions. And with that, I will pass you on to Ian Acon, who's going to talk through the UK NRCGT changes.
Thank you. I'm going to provide a quick overview on the forthcoming changes for the taxation of non-residents that are holding UK property. I think it's just worth noting that there's two changes coming up in future years. There's one April 2019, which now applies UK capital gains tax, or CGT, to non-residents, in particular for commercial property. And then also in April 2020, there's a transition from the NRL regime from UK income tax to UK corporation tax, which I'll call the NRL transition. So, whilst these are being done over the next 2 years, we would very much recommend that both changes are considered on the round, simply because you would have to consider both of these changes when considering how you're going to structure your investments going forward. One key observation with that is that we would expect that communication and knowledge of your investors would be needed more going forwards in order to understand and implement the right tax answer. In particular, I think historically, investment structures have been quite agnostic to investor tax profiles. Now, whilst the UK government is trying to create a level playing field for both onshore and offshore structures, what this means is in order to get the right tax answer for qualifying investors, you're going to need good communication between both the fund and investors. So in terms of these two changes, taking the NRL transition first, and if we just move to the next slide. In terms of the NRL transition, I think the key thing here is just to say, so previously the NRL regime was being taxed in the relatively simple income tax regime, and as that's now moving to the corporation tax regime, which is a bit more complex, you'll have to think about certain tax provisions that could impact the tax answer of the structure. This includes interest restrictions and hybrid rules in particular. Moving on to the next slide. So this will be the looking at the NRCGT regime, which comes into effect in April 2019. What this says is that there'll be both direct charges and indirect charges that could now apply to non-resident investors into UK property. And it's worth noting that this doesn't just apply to third-party sales, but it also can apply to events such as the granting of leases for a premium. In respect to commercial property, there'll be a rebasing as well from April 2019. So actually the CGT charge will only apply to any accrued appreciation that has arisen from April 2019. Exemptions are still available to relevant investors, but the question is, will the investors have access to those exemptions? And that's what investment funds will need to consider. In terms of indirect interests, there's two considerations to think about when looking at the CGT implications, and this will apply to interest in shares, collective investment vehicles, etc. And the two requirements are the land rich condition, whereby any entity needs to have more than 75% of its value in UK property, and the second condition is a 25% holdings test, and that means an investor would need to hold more than 25% of that entity. So it's worth noting that there are some special considerations in respect of collective investment vehicles, and we'll move on to the next slide in that respect. And here, the specific rules here are saying if you do fall into the collective investment vehicle rules, then there are some certain other considerations that would need to be thought about. The first question is, well, what is a collective investment vehicle? Now, this falls under the definition as outlined in FISMA for a collective investment scheme, and also includes things like alternative investment funds, UK REITs, and overseas equivalents. The main one of the main points to note is that the 25% holdings test is switched off. And so if an investor holds, say, 1%, then that means they would fall into this charge. Now, the default position is that unless a collective investment vehicle is a partnership, all the vehicles are considered by default as a corporate vehicle. Now, in order to provide investors with the most appropriate exemptions or allow them to access the exemptions, there's two actions that could be made, and these are positive actions that need to be taken by the collective investment vehicles. And the two elections that could be made is the transparency regime or the exemption regime. Both regimes have their own sets of conditions and set of requirements and obligations that will need to be met. Now, for the purposes of this webinar, I'm not proposing to go through them in any real detail, but just so the next slides, we'll look at them from a high level perspective. Looking at the next slide, so the transparency regime, the main conditions here is that all investors need to consent to this election, and also that this only applies to vehicles that are transparent for income. And effectively what this does, it treats the vehicle, the fund, is transparent for CGT purposes, and therefore moves the tax points up to the investor. And if the investors are exempt for UK tax purposes, then this will allow them to get retain the best tax answer. It's worth noting that this election needs to be made within 12 months of the start of the period in which it relates. So, i.e., if you want it to relate to the 2019 year, you have until April 2020 to make the election. The transparency election is irrevocable. In terms of ongoing requirements, you'll be required to file annual partnership returns. Moving on to the next slide, the exemption regime. So again, there's various conditions that need to be met. I think the main difference between this and the previous regime is that rather than treating the fund vehicle as transparent, it will treat everything within it as exempt for tax purposes. And then the tax point, again, will only arise once the investor exits from the fund. The next slide outlines a couple of steps and considerations in what investors and investment funds should be doing in this regard. Broadly, what we'd say is, well, you need to understand how these rules could be impacting your structures and whether or not any action needs to be taken. And finally, having good communication between the fund and the investors to ensure the correct answer is being reached. And finally, the last slide on this section just provides a summary of the timings in this, for these changes, and in particular when elections need to be made, i.e. by April 2020, if you like it to apply for 2019. Moving on.
So just to close out the session, some words on the Channel Islands and Cayman Islands substance requirements. So next slide, thanks. As part of a review of over 90 jurisdictions, the EU's Code of Conduct group concluded that the Channel Islands and other crown dependencies were compliant with most of the EU principles of good tax governance, including the general principles of fair taxation, but concerns were raised around the lack of substance requirements. The Channel Islands governments both launched public consultations in 2018 and have recently brought into effect a three-stage approach to determining the revised substance requirements. So the first step is the identification of companies which are carrying on relevant activities. So in the Channel Islands, I'd point out that these rules do only apply to companies. So trusts, partnerships, and branches aren't going to be in scope for the enhanced substance requirements. That being said, in Cayman, it is expected that Cayman companies, LLPs, and LLCs are generally going to be expected to be caught and subject to the same provisions. So for ease of use, I'll use the word company, but just to note that's not a strict usage for the purpose of Cayman entities. Beginning in 2020, all relevant entities will need to notify the tax authorities as to whether any relevant activities were undertaken, which relevant activity was undertaken, and whether it was any part of the gross income in relation to those activities were subject to tax outside Jersey, Guernsey, or Cayman. And if so, tax residency may need to be certified. Relevant activities are defined in each of the relevant specific laws and broadly include banking, distribution and service centre functions, fund management, holding company activities, intellectual property, and several other categories. So the second stage of the proposed and implemented approach is the imposition of substance requirements on those companies in scope. So if we move on to the next slide, the first requirement is that they be directed and managed in the jurisdiction. So that does go a little beyond the scope of centrally managed and control. And actually what it's going to require is that local board meetings are held at adequate frequencies and given the level of decision making required. There will be a physical presence quorum required of those board meetings, and strategic decisions should be set out at the meetings of the board and minuted in a manner that reflects the decision-making function. All company records and minutes will be kept locally, and the board as a whole will have to have the necessary...
Can I have your attention, please? There will be a test...
Apologies for that. We will also be looking at core income generating activities. So companies will need to demonstrate that the core income generation activities associated with the entities are undertaken locally, which could include portfolio management, the calculation of risks and reserves, hedging positions, and preparation of regulatory and investor reports. It's recognised that for collective investment vehicles, substance requirements should be reduced as they're different from a general corporate. For collectives, we broadly expect that the three jurisdictions will have an aligned approach to substance going forward. The final stage is the enforcement of the substance requirements, and in order to demonstrate a meaningful commitment to the EU conduct group, there is going to be a formal hierarchy for non-compliant companies. In the first few years, there'll be a financial penalty, but for repeat offenders, the penalties will increase and actually could end up with escalation to the local authority. and initiate strike-off procedures. I think in terms of the challenges, there's going to be a real need to think about staffing requirements and evidencing that due time is spent on any relevant activities. And for example, if you look at the administrator sector, considering how charging structures might reflect the relative efforts spent performing each task. So that's it on substance requirements, and I don't know if there's any questions. So I don't think we've got any questions just at the moment. So I think with that, we'll round out, and just to thank everyone again for dialing in to the Link and Learn. Thank you.